I'm Winfred Neely, and I am the chair of the Division of Applied Theology and Church Ministries here at Moody Bible Institute. Our program head of the Biblical Preaching major and professor of preaching. And every year, we are on the lookout for students, student preachers that we believe are walking with God, honoring Jesus, hard workers, and also with the gifts from God Himself to communicate His word. And our speaker this afternoon, Michael Madewell, Michael, who was like God and made well. I mean, that's just interesting. I'm thinking, okay, that's an interesting etymology. And his parents are here. His mom and his dad are here to support him and other friends. And he's from Beecher, Illinois, a pastoral a ministry major, and he graduates in a few weeks, really. And so it is my great privilege and honor to welcome Michael Madewell to come and speak to us this afternoon. So give him a nice, Moody welcome.
Hey, everyone. Before I begin, I'd like to thank Dr. Neely and everyone else who was involved with giving me this opportunity. As soon as it was offered to me, you know, of course, I hit my knees in prayer, and the first thing I prayed was, like, God, please help me do this well, help the people who hear it to get something out of it. And secondly, I prayed, whatever day they put me on, just let it be low pressure. So I ended up being put sandwiched between Michael Rodelnik and the president of Moody and finding out that my graduation might be on the line. So God has a sense of humor. But before I begin, let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for this time that we have to come together and to learn about you. I pray that if there's anything that I say that is wrong or that you don't want to be heard, that it would be quickly forgotten. But anything that I say that is of you, and of your spirit, I pray that it would stick in the hearts and minds of the people who hear it, and that they would be able to take it and apply it to their lives. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So the greatest and oldest emotion of mankind is fear. The greatest and oldest kind of fear is fear of the unknown. This is a quote by H.P. Lovecraft, who, despite some of his more obvious character flaws, wrote some of the most successful and suspenseful horror literature in the entire genre. The reason is because he understood that what we fear is that which is unknown or uncertain. Now, I feel this in my own life on a deep spiritual level every time I see a spider. Because I'm telling you, spiders are the ninjas of the animal kingdom. You know, I just found out that there's a spider in Australia that can actually flatten its body and wrap itself around a tree branch to make itself look like it's part of the branch. So you could just be strolling along, having a nice little nature walk, and then bam, spider attack. That's terrifying. My dad likes to make fun of me because I'm this big and spiders are this big, but that's the problem. You ever stepped on a spider and you pick up your foot and suddenly it's gone and you realize you may be moments away from death. But it's not only that you don't know where they are, it's how poisonous are they? Like, if you get bit by a spider, you got a choice to make. You're gonna run to the store and get some anti-itch cream, or do you make a last phone call to a loved one? Because honestly, it's a 50-50. Now, I'm being silly, but I say all that to make the point that it is the uncertainty that brings fear in whatever situation it may be, big or small. But on a more serious note, think of why you might feel fear in your Christian life. Have you ever sat down with your student bill and compared it to your projected income in ministry and thought to yourself, ooh, is it really worth it? Or maybe you're not a student, but you look at your tithes and your offerings, and then you compare that to your bills, and you know that God has promised to provide, but you haven't seen it yet. And so you're looking around going, well, what if I can't make it this time? I'm not sure I want to do this anymore. But maybe it's not the fear of what if. Maybe it's the fear of what could have been. Do you ever look at the people around you who are unbelievers, and you look at your own life having chosen to follow God, and you see that they have so much more, they seem so much happier, they have so many more possessions, and you look at your own life and you're struggling and you're having all these problems and you think, maybe I made the wrong choice. And you have this fear of, what if things could have been better? Well, for me, I was a fire cadet for about a year and a half, and if I had stuck with it, I would have been hired on at 18. I would have had a career job already, stable, 24 hours on, 48 off, good pay, no debt. They would have paid for my schooling. I mean, I would have been like living the Dave Ramsey dream. And it would be easy for me to look at that and then to look at the struggles that I've had in ministry and trying to work my way towards it and the struggles that will come with ministry, because I know they'll be there, and to say, man, I could have had it so much better. What if I didn't make the right choice? Now, if I knew that ministry would be successful and bring a lot of people to God and make enough money for me to provide for my family, then of course there would be no reason to be afraid, right? But the problem is, we can't always have that kind of certainty. God doesn't always let us know when or how or even if we're going to make it through a particular situation. In fact, most of the time, he doesn't let us know those things. And so, it might feel like that's what you need in order to be able to move forward. It might feel like you need a certainty of the outcome before you can move forward with courage. But I'm here to tell you that's not the case. I know because of the story that I'm going to share with you today from Daniel chapter 3. The story of three young men who stood firm in their faith, even in the midst of worldly uncertainty. But before we go there, I'm going to read from Daniel chapter 1. I'm going to start in verse 1 and just give us a little bit of background about who these characters are. So again, that's Daniel chapter 1, verse 1. It says, in the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came to Jerusalem and besieged it. And the Lord delivered Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand, along with some of the articles from the temple of God. And these he carried off to the temple of his God in Babylonia, and put in the treasure house of his God. And then the king ordered Ashpenaz, chief of his court officials, to bring in some of the Israelites from the royal family and the nobility, young men without any physical defect, handsome, and showing aptitude for all kinds of learning, well-informed, quick to understand, and qualified to serve in the king's palace. And he was to teach them the language and the literature of the Babylonians. And the king assigned them a daily amount of food and wine from the king's table, and they were trained for 3 years, and after that they were to enter into the king's service. So these three young men were torn away from their homes and their friends and their families. They're forced to serve the king of the very nation that has invaded them. And they're indoctrinated into this new culture. They're taught new customs and a new language. And not only that, but their names are changed from meanings that had to do with their God, the true God, to meanings that had to do with the Babylonian gods. They were stripped of their very identities, and yet they were willing to move into their circumstances without grumbling or complaining. And so they're put in charge of some of the king's affairs, and one day, King Nebuchadnezzar wakes up, and he looks out over this empty plain, and he thinks to himself, you know what we need? A 90-foot golden statue. It's a little excessive if you ask me. I think there might have been a better use of the space, but I am not king. So that's where our story begins, in Daniel chapter 3, verse 1. It says, King Nebuchadnezzar made an image of gold 90 feet high and 9 feet wide, set it up on the plain of Dura in the province of Babylon. He summoned the satraps, prefects, governors, advisors, treasurers, judges, magistrates, and all other provincial officials to come to the dedication of the image that he had set up. And so the satraps, prefects, governors, advisors, treasurers, judges, magistrates, and all other provincial officials assembled for the dedication of the image that King Nebuchadnezzar had set up, and they stood before it. And then the herald loudly proclaimed, "This is what you are commanded to do, O peoples, nations, and men of every language. As soon as you hear the sound of the horn, flute, zither, lyre, harp, pipes, and all kinds of music, you must fall down and worship the image of gold that King Nebuchadnezzar has set up. And whoever does not fall down and worship will immediately be thrown into the blazing furnace." So now, not only have these young men been torn away from their homes and their friends and their families, indoctrinated into a new culture, stripped of their identities, now they're thrown into this meeting with all these other people who have power, and they're told, "You must act the way that we act or you will die." And not only will they will die a horrible, agonizing, burning death. This is so much more than just cultural peer pressure. And they were young. Imagine being pulled out of your seventh grade class or your eighth grade class, and you're thrown into a meeting with some foreign nation, maybe the Federation of Russia. And you got the prime minister and the deputy prime ministers and all the governors and all the official people there, and they're all saying, "You have to act the way that we act or you will die." And what's worse is that what they were asked to do isn't even that difficult, because it was just a bow. And they could have said to themselves, "Well, if I bow now, then the king will look at me and he'll think that I'm loyal, but God knows where my heart is. God knows where my true allegiances lie. It's a win-win. We look good on both sides." But they didn't, because they understood that their outward actions were just as important as their inward motivations, because they were representing God to the hostile culture around them. And so they stood firm, even in the midst of this terrible threat. And the story continues in verse 7. It says, "Therefore, as soon as they heard the sound of the horn, flute, zither, lyre, harp, and all kinds of music, all the peoples, nations, and men of every language fell down and worshipped the image of gold that King Nebuchadnezzar had set up. But at this time, some astrologers came forward and denounced the Jews. And they said to King Nebuchadnezzar, 'O king, live forever. For you have issued a decree, O king, that whoever hears the sound of the horn, flute, zither, lyre, harp, pipes, and all kinds of music must fall down and worship the image of gold. And that whoever does not fall down and worship will be thrown into the blazing furnace. But there are some Jews whom you have set over the affairs of the province of Babylon, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who pay no attention to you, O king. They neither serve your gods nor worship the image of gold that you have set up.'" So these astrologers, they're going to the king, and you can almost hear it in the language when they say, "There are some Jews that you have set over the province, over the affairs of the province of Babylon." This is in verse 12. They say that, and then they name them Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. It's almost like they're like, "Hey, king, I'm not going to name any names, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Some guys are disobeying you." And they're doing this, it seems, from the text and from what we've seen in other places, it seems like that was just kind of the political climate at the time. Like, hey, if we can get these guys in trouble, we could maybe move up in the world, you know? That's where the VeggieTales song comes from, you know, in the Daniel episode, and they're like, "Oh no, what we gonna do? The king likes Daniel more than me and you. Oh no, what we gonna do? Gotta get him out of here," right? And that's like, that's the mindset of these astrologers. Well, thank you. That's the mindset of these astrologers here is, hey, I can move up in the world. It doesn't matter that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego have to die a horrible burning death for it. I get a promotion. And this is the cruelty of the culture that they're living in. Let that sink in for a second. But they still stood firm. And in verse 13, it continues, "Furious with rage, Nebuchadnezzar summoned Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. So these men were brought before the king. And Nebuchadnezzar said to them, 'Is it true, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that you do not serve my gods or worship the image of gold that I have set up?' Now when you hear the sound of the horn, flute, zither, lyre, harp, pipes, and all kinds of music, if you are ready to fall down and worship the image of gold that I have made, then very good. But if you do not worship it, you will be thrown immediately into the blazing furnace. And then what God will be able to rescue you from my hand? So, whether it's because he's feeling particularly merciful that day, or because he believes that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego are too young to fully understand the gravity of the situation, or because he just wants to be seen as benevolent in the eyes of his people, which honestly is the most likely, he decides to give Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego a second chance. But while he believes he's giving them a second chance at life, what he's truly doing is giving them a second chance to get into trouble and to be disobedient. And to them, it might have immediately looked like a way out, like a way to avoid this terrible fate. And sometimes we look at our own lives and we have circumstances, maybe a job that we don't like or a church that we're having problems at. And something happens and we see it as a way out. But sometimes those ways out are hard to discern. Like, is this of God or is it not? And the only thing I would say is, if you look at that and you say, do I have to compromise my integrity in order to take this way out? Then it's not of God. And they recognize that. And so in verse 16, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego replied to the king, "Oh, Nebuchadnezzar, we do not need to defend ourselves before you in this matter." Notice how they address him here. "Oh, Nebuchadnezzar." All up until this point, he has been addressed as, "O king, O king, live forever. O king, these Jews defy you. O king, make your decrees last." And now we see that they address him as, "O Nebuchadnezzar." They are reminding him, and no doubt reminding themselves in a time of fear, that while he is a great king with vast influence, great wealth, and even given some authority over their earthly lives, he is still just a man. And no man can back up his mockery of God. But that's what he's doing here in verse 15. He's mocking God, saying, "What God will be able to rescue you from my hand?" Have any of you ever seen the movie The Count of Monte Cristo? That's good. For those of you who haven't, I will pray for you. But it's a fantastic movie. There's a part in the movie where Edmond Dantès finds himself in prison, and the prison warden is going to beat him. And he says, "God will give me justice." And the prison warden kind of mocks him and says, "God is never in France this time of year." And he says, "God is everywhere. He sees everything." And the warden says, "Well, I'll tell you what. I'll get the whip. You ask God for help. And I'll stop the moment he shows up." And that's kind of what's happening here. Is Nebuchadnezzar is looking at Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and saying, "You think you're doing the right thing. You think that you are serving this God and being faithful, and yet I'm about to throw you into the furnace and I don't see anybody around to help you out. What God is going to save you from my hand?" And yet, even though they've already stood against the threats, now they're willing to stand against the mockery. In verse 17, they said, "If we are thrown into the blazing furnace, the God that we serve is able to save us from it, and he will rescue us from your hand, O king." But what's really striking is the second half of their response in verse 18. They said, "But even if he does not, even if he does not, we want you to know, O king, that we will not serve your gods or worship the image of gold that you have set up." Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego had a faith that was strong enough to go beyond the certainty that God would rescue them from their situation. But a faith that was strong enough to move on to say, "Even if he does not rescue me, I will still be faithful." Because they understood that this life is short. And eventually we're going to lose it anyway. And it didn't matter if they were going to be rescued from the flames, because there is an ultimate rescue in God. And we all have that ultimate rescue, but sometimes when we get to this place and things look really bad and we look around and we can't see God, we start to forget about that. But they didn't. They still stood firm. And in verse 19, it says, Nebuchadnezzar was furious with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and his attitude toward them changed. He ordered the furnace heated 7 times hotter than usual and commanded some of the strongest soldiers in his armies to tie up Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and throw them into the blazing furnace. And so these men, wearing their robes, trousers, turbans, and other clothes, were bound and thrown into the blazing furnace. And the king's command was so urgent, and the furnace was so hot, that the flames of the fire killed the soldiers who took up Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And these 3 men, firmly tied, fell into the blazing furnace. So now they're in. They're falling into the furnace. This is it. And God still hasn't shown up, or so it would seem. But God has been with them the whole time. And they knew that. But it wasn't obvious. And sometimes it is hard to see God. But they understood what Paul is talking about in Romans 8, 24 through 25, when he says, hope that is seen is not hope. Who hopes in what he sees? But if we hope in what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. And so that's what they were doing. They were willing to stand against the threats. They were willing to stand against the mockery. They were waiting patiently for God's rescue. And now here they are, falling into the furnace. And this is the place where if they had fear, this is where it all culminates. It could be the fear of the what if, as they're falling into the flames and they think, what if this hurts a lot worse than I thought it was gonna? Or what if this lasts a lot longer than I thought it was gonna? And what if God doesn't decide to rescue us this time? And the fear of the what could have been, as they hear the soldiers dying behind them, and they realize that all of this could have been avoided if they had just bowed. And sometimes you might find yourself in a place like that, a place where all of your fears culminate. Sometimes a spark of worry in our lives blazes into a furnace of fear, and we're looking around, and in front of us we see flames, and behind us we hear agony, and all around us we cannot see God. And we start to fool ourselves into believing that he's not actually there. And this is when the enemy thinks he's won, right? And he starts rubbing his hands together like, I got him now. Because now they're scared. And now they don't think God is with them. But we know that that's wrong. Because we know that there is an ultimate rescue in God, because it says so in his word, and we read it and we know that it is the truth. And if you're in a place like that right now, then I want to encourage you, because they didn't stay there long. You see, in verse 24, to borrow a line from Dr. Neely, it's as if King Nebuchadnezzar is having some eye trouble. And he leapt to his feet in amazement and asked his advisors, he's kind of going, hey, weren't there 3 men that we tied up and threw in the fire? And they replied, certainly, O king, because of course they're not going to disagree with the king. That's a terrible idea. And in verse 25, he said, look, I see 4 men walking around in the fire, unbound and unharmed, and the 4th looks like a son of the gods. Do you see what's happening here? God showed up in a real, tangible way. His power was made manifest to the rescue of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Now, there's some debate over whether or not this was an angel or the pre-incarnate Christ who was with them in the furnace. I don't have time to answer that question, but it is obvious that God and his power is manifest in a person in the furnace with them. But you see, this tangible aspect of God's power, to where they could truly see it, didn't show up until they were already in the flames. Now, he was with them the whole time, yeah, but he was hard to see. And sometimes we don't see God until we get to that place. But too many of us think of God as this wall who's supposed to keep us from these hard times, and we fall into hard times when we lose a job or we lose some money, or maybe we lose a loved one. And I don't want to make light of any of that, because I know that it's all difficult and it's all a struggle, and it doesn't make it any easier per se knowing that God is with us, but it does keep us from being engulfed by that despair. And so, in verse 26, Nebuchadnezzar approached the opening of the blazing furnace. And he said, "Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, servants of the Most High God, come out, come here." And so Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they came out of the fire. And the satraps, the prefects, the governors, and the royal advisors crowded around them, and they saw that the fire had not harmed their bodies, nor was a hair on their heads singed. Their robes were not scorched, and there was not even a smell of fire on them. These guys weren't just rescued from this situation. It was as if they hadn't even gone through it in the first place. Now, when we're telling this story in a Sunday school class with the little felt boards, this is how it usually ends, is Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were saved from the fire, and that's great. But that's not how the story ends. You see, this isn't a story about three young men who were miraculously saved from a fire, although that is miraculous and worthy of praise, and praise God that he is able to do such things. But the story continues in verse 28. It says, "Nebuchadnezzar said, 'Praise be to the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who has sent his angel and rescued his servants. They trusted in him. They defied the king's command, and they were willing to give up their lives rather than serve or worship any god except their own. Therefore, I decree that the people of any nation or language who say anything against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego be cut into pieces and their houses be turned into piles of rubble. For no other god can save in this way.'" And then the king promoted Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the province of Babylon. So the true point of this story is that if you follow God, you will be promoted. Nobody's paying attention. The true point of this story isn't that three young men were saved from a fire, although again, that is miraculous and worthy of praise. The true point of this story is that because three young men were willing to stand firm in their faith in the midst of the threats, in the midst of the mockery, and in the midst of being engulfed with the flames of the furnace, an entire nation was introduced to the power of God. Imagine what this nation, what this world could be like if every group of three people in here had enough strength and courage and faith like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego to be able to go out and represent God to this hostile culture the way that they did. Because when the threats came, they stood firm in their faith. And when they were mocked, and not only they were mocked, God was mocked to their face, but they stood firm in their faith. And when they were engulfed by the flames, they stood firm in their faith. So how do we emulate their strong and courageous behavior? It is by staying in constant prayer and reading of the word. And that might sound generic, because too often it's presented to us as like, hey, this is what you have to do. You have to go home and you have to pray and you have to read the word because it's what you have to do. And too many people think that praying is something they have to do or they're supposed to do, or that reading the Bible is something that they're supposed to do or they have to do. But how many times have you opened up your Bible and you read something, maybe a verse, maybe a chapter, maybe a book, but but you close it and you forget what you just read. Because you've only read it for the sake of reading it. But that's not the purpose. So what is the purpose? Why do we pray and why do we read Scripture? It is to remind ourselves day in and day out that God is with us, that He loves us, and He cares for us, and to put ourselves in a proper place where we can be like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and say, you know what? I don't have to have an immediate rescue. And when you find yourself engulfed in the flames of despair, in the fear and the doubts and the worries of this world, you can say, no, I don't have to be afraid, and I don't have to know the immediate outcome, because I know who's with me in the midst of these circumstances, and I know that there is an ultimate rescue in God. And so we follow the example of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in that way. But I have even better news. Better news than all of what I have just said. Because Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were not the only example that we have to follow. You see, there was another who came after them and long before us. And he was not torn from his home, but he left it willingly to come to a place where he knew that he would be threatened and mocked and engulfed in the grave. But when they threatened him, he did not bow. And when they mocked him, they tore out the hairs of his beard and they spat in his face. And they hit him with sticks and they said, prophesy, who hit you? He did not bow. And when he was engulfed in the despair of this world, taking the entirety of our sin, of the darkness and the depravity of this world on his shoulders alone. Think of all of the things that I just mentioned, all of the struggles and the fears and the worries, and how much your own struggles, fears, and worries weigh upon you. And then imagine all of the struggles and the fears and the cares and the worries and the sins and the guilt of everyone in the entire world, in the entire history of the world, and he took that upon his shoulders and he did not bow. He stood firm in the relationship that he had with the Father, enduring the cross, scorning its shame for the joy that was set before him. And you know what? There wasn't an immediate rescue because he had to endure the pain of the cross. But 3 days later, he took up his life again, proving to us that there is an ultimate rescue in God. If only we put our faith in the right place, if we stand firm as well. And so I ask you, as followers of our glorious Lord Jesus Christ, I have one question for you today. When the world threatens you and tells you that your ministry will come to nothing, or when people keep making these predictions that the church will be wiped out in 10 years, 15 years, when the world mocks you and tells you that you could have had such a better life if you had chosen any path other than following God, and when you feel yourself being engulfed in all of the things that are around you that make it dark, that make it so that you cannot see God, will you stand firm in the relationship that you have built up through prayer and reading God's word day in and day out, so that you can see him in the light times, so that when those dark times come, you can remind yourself that even though you can't see him, he is still there? Will you do these things? Will you be strong and courageous in your faith? Or will you bow? Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I pray that something that I have said today would be useful. I pray that you would just give us the ability to be strong and courageous in our faith, because we know that we could not do it if it wasn't for your power in us. And so I pray that each of us would have a healthy dose of the Holy Spirit to be able to allow us to stand up and say, we know that you are with us, even in the times when we cannot see you. And I pray that those times if it is within your will, would be few and far between, and that your presence would be as obvious as possible so that we could rejoice in you always. And I pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.